You realize that's 35 years ago? 35 years ago. Do I have a clicker somewhere for advancing the slides? Ladies and gentlemen, thank you, first of all. I am partially embarrassed when I look at that 35-year-old situation. You know, there's an axiom in law that says if you have the facts, you pound on the jury. If you don't have the facts, you pound on the table. Now think about it. We were only, that's 1980. We didn't really have much in the way of evidence. We had lots of anecdotal stories. We had lots of things that were out there that we knew as chiropractors practicing chiropractic, seeing the results of it every day in our, but we didn't have any proof. All we had was anecdotal stories. So those were very tough times. Fundamentally, however, the same situation exists today. So, first of all, I'm not going to get up on this stage. I have this thing where I have to walk around, so bear with me. My message today, hopefully, will be one. Okay, let me just give you some background. I graduated from Palmer College in 1962. And this is Friday the 13th. I want you to realize that somebody who graduated from Palmer in 1962 can still stand up, walk, take nourishment, do all kinds of good stuff. So there's hope for you guys after to be in practice 53 years from now. I graduated from Palmer College in a very, very interesting time. And I want you to think for a moment about the time frame. 1962. Little did we realize as students at that time that 1 year later there would be a document that would be published by the American Medical Association from their Committee on Quackery, whose goal was to contain and eliminate the profession of chiropractic. Now, that's not going to happen in 2016, so those of you got a piece of cake. Piece of cake, guys. So when you think about it, I want you to put things in context. As I said to Dr. Barrett, we've got to put everything in context at the time frames that we were talking about, at the era we were talking about. So I graduated in 62, never knew what was going to befall me in 63. But what we did learn from the old masters, from the Dr. Galen Prices of the world, from the Virgil Strangs of the world, was that there was a situation in which we were learned about lifestyle, we learned about health, we learned about a philosophy, essentially. I recall sitting in the class and hearing Dr. Price tell us that we didn't have a cold, we had a hot. I'm thinking, this guy must be from Mars. What the hell is he talking about? Well, what he was talking about, of course, is that a cold really is an inflammation, and an inflammation produces heat. So we didn't really have a cold, we had a hot. And all of a sudden, you know, your mind starts to think in a very different way. Your mind starts to think about a philosophy of self-responsibility. And so there were a couple of models. One of the core models was obviously the famous three-legged stool, body, mind, and spirit, intelligent force and matter. So if you picture this little stool here with three legs, all of them must be perfectly, perfectly balanced. If one of those three legs are imbalanced, something's wrong with the pyramid. Something's wrong with the stool. So it doesn't really matter which of those. So we can't get focused because they're all of equal importance, and that's the thing that we got to remember, that body, mind, and spirit are of equal importance, and we're now coming to recognize that how we think influences the cellular memory. Real current stuff. And all of a sudden, back then, we're talking about this, And these instructors at Palmer College in the late 50s and early 60s are telling us as students about this. No evidence, no support, but fundamentally a different model, a different paradigm. One that hadn't been tested or validated, but one that has withstood the test of time from those who keenly observed the environment, like the Chinese, in acupuncture over thousands and thousands of years, recognized that there were meridians, that there were trigger points, that there were all of these things. Why? By the powers of observation. So that was one of the models. That was fundamental from a standpoint of a practitioner. But then there was a second model. The second model was one that we live with every day, folks. Politics, education, and research. And this is the three-legged stool. This is the model that clinicians have very, very difficult time with. And I'll tell you why. So here's my disclaimer. Everybody, I know enough about law to know you got to start off with a disclaimer. My disclaimer is, A, I'm not a researcher, I'm not an educator, I'm not a politician, although some would disagree. I am, however, a practitioner. Just like Sam Irvin, for those of you old enough to remember Sam Irvin, he was a guy who took down Nixon in the Watergate hearings, and he just simply said, I'm just a country boy practicing in a small town, and that was me. I'm a practitioner. So it's from this vantage point, folks, that I'm going to talk to you about today. This is the real world, the lessons that I learned. The model of the early years, if you got hung up on any one of those legs, you get pretty dogmatic. So let me just tell you about this. I started off in a small town of 5,000 people. That's where I started. That's where I ended up 53 years later. Little community. Now I want to put this in perspective here. The community was a community of Pennsylvania Dutch people. So now I come into town. I'm young. I'm single. I'm Italian, the only Italian in town. And I'm a chiropractor. How the hell much more could you have going against you? So I come into this town, a little town of 5,000 people, and I thought, well, it would look like a nice little town. It was suggested to me by one of the equipment company people. He said, you know, there's a little town about 25 miles north of where I was born. It might be a nice town. So I went up there, drove through the town, nice wide streets. It looked like a nice community. I said, all right, I'll open up. Opened up in a little office, and I don't want to exaggerate, but let me tell you, it was a small office. I had to actually literally back into my own private office so that I could walk out. That's how tiny my private office was. It used to be a barbershop. Guy was a barbershop for like 40 years before the old gentleman got so old that he had to finally decide to retire. And he rented out the office to me, okay? Now, understand, I had no knowledge about the AMA, but picture this now. I'm on a corner. I'm on one corner. Across the street from me, on a diagonal, is the office of the general practitioner in town, Dr. Williams. I won't put any other initials or any other pejorative terms when I think lovingly about that SOB. But the bottom line is, he was directly across the street from me. And on the other corner, folks, was a funeral home. Now, I guess it doesn't take much of a stretch of imagination. First of all, the medical physician refused to take care of Mr. Chamberlain, who was the old gentleman who rented me my office. He refused to take care of him anymore. And he basically told Chamberlain, don't take your for rent sign down because that quack is only going to last a couple of months. And then everybody who walked into his office, he suggested to them that if they went to the quack, they would wind up at Schnitter, which was the name of the funeral home. Welcome to Pomerton. You ask what was in store? I could not even comprehend this. Went in there every day to my office and wondered what was happening here. Why was this happening? Well, early on, here's what I didn't know. And every one of you are blessed, because here's the message. Here's the takeaway message today. Here's what I didn't know that I wish I would have known, and which you are now fortunately aware of. The path to tomorrow is integration. We'll talk about this in just a moment. And I want to remember a famous quote from one of our early educators, C.O. Watkins, who said, and I hope you'll write this one down, "Be bold in what we hypothesize and be cautious in what we claim." Foundation of education. So, here we come. When I graduated from Palmer College, everybody had an idea what their practice was going to be. I wanted to have a maintenance practice. I couldn't even spell maintenance back then, but I wanted to have a maintenance practice. I wanted to see 1,000 happy, healthy people once a month. That's what I wanted. That's what my goal was. Well, guess what? That's what my goal ultimately became. I had 1,000 happy, healthy people who came to my office. Now, understand, throughout that process of selection, I had to discard a lot of people that didn't fit into my model. They went someplace else. Some folks liked PI work. Some folks liked workers' comp. Some folks liked sports. Some folks liked whatever. I happened to like maintenance practice. It was one of my deals. So I started out with a maintenance practice. Now, that maintenance practice kind of got known a little bit about in the community of chiropractic. And in 1992, I just want to tell you a little funny story, so sometimes you get kicked in the head and don't know it. In 1992, the profession embarked on a fortuitous situation called the Mercy Guidelines. And Dr. Scott Haldeman called me up and he said, "You know, I know you brag about your maintenance practice. I want you to write the chapter on mercy on maintenance." Piece of cake. So I went there, and for months I labored, because as I looked up and did what you now can go to the library and do in a literature search, guess what? I came up with enough research to fit on the back of a postage stamp. There just wasn't anything to support what I had been physically doing for all these years. How can that be? So when I sent my final document into Haldeman, I'll never forget the comment he made to me. Sometimes he's cruel. He said to me, "Lou, that's a fantastic commencement address. Go back and rewrite it and give me some proof." And I was deflated. I thought it was a pretty good commencement address, though, I must confess, you know. So let me just tell you a little bit about it. When you graduated from Palmer College, I mean, there were those of us who were sort of philosophically inclined. Now, I'm not looking at you for any reason at all when I saw about growing hair at a bowling ball. I'm not going to pick on you at all. But we really thought we could grow hair on a bowling ball if you corrected an atlas adjustment with, incidentally, a toggle recoil. Now, toggle recoils, I want you to know, we used to have a tie clip on the bottom of our tie so that we would know the proper angle that the tie would be to get directly over the atlas vertebra. And then you would carefully and strategically place your hands and then deliver that dynamic thrust. You want to see it again? It's quick. Mine is fast, folks. Now, the other thing I learned at Palmer College, which I wish we'd all learned a little earlier in life, in the bathroom, in the cafeteria at Palmer College, above the urinal, was the best words I've ever learned. I didn't know what they meant at first, but above the urinal, at Palmer College, it said, rule number 9, don't take yourself too damn seriously. And you know what, folks? That's probably some of the best advice I didn't understand at the time, fully understand today. I don't take myself too damn seriously. So other than the fact that I realized and practiced that I couldn't grow hair in a bowling ball because no matter how long you were with me, there was nothing coming up. Oh, wait a minute. I couldn't be a failure. How could you be a failure? It works every time, all the time, every time. So here's what we develop. We develop this comfort excuse. Now think about this. Have you ever heard of retracing, folks? Okay. If the patient came in and never came back, they were either better, or if they got worse, it was retracing. How could you lose? How could you lose with that kind of a belief system, folks? It made us almost into invincible, non-thinking people. Everything was cool. Everything was good. How can it be any better than this? I got everybody well. They either got retracing or they got better. Well, here's the crossroads. What we believe and what we can prove are two very different things. And holding on to a philosophy that's rational versus a belief that is dogma. Always an open mind, always an open mind in the process of what we do, and recognizing that we can't rely on that illusion, or should I say delusion, of not being wrong. Go back to square one and investigate again. So, let me tell you a little personal story. I want those who think that this guy, Sportelli, and incidentally, you realize this is Friday the 13th. This guy, Sportelli, you know what the hell he's talking about. He had no philosophy. He can't be a real practitioner. Let me tell you something, folks. Let me just tell you a personal story. As you can probably and have already ascertained by now, I'm Italian. And you know why Italians have short necks and flat foreheads? Because you ask them a question, they go like this. Give them the answer, they go like this. Rule number 9. I'm Italian and I'm born with Mediterranean anemia. I was born with a condition called thalassemia. How many of you know what thalassemia is? Okay, good. A bunch of folks in this audience know what thalassemia is. It's a genetic condition in Italians. I do not have one mature red cell in my body. That's what I say is why I act so immature. I don't have any mature cells in my body. My hemoglobin is very low. I should theoretically not be able to walk back and forth in this auditorium. If you looked at my, every time I get a blood test, they go ballistic. They think I'm suffering from lead poisoning, or they want to send me to oncologists, because thalassemia has its inherent condition. And yes, I have no mature cells. Yes, I have low hemoglobin. Yes, I should be chronically fatigued, and I was as a little kid. Didn't know why. We were poor. Couldn't go to a practitioner to find out what was wrong. I went to Palmer College, and of course they forced you to go into a clinical examination at that time. We had one MD on campus. His name was Dr. Andrews. And Dr. Andrews was a picture of health. Constantly with a cigarette in his mouth. And so we did our blood test, and we had, guess what? He looked at the blood and he said, "Whew, you got to go somewhere." So he sent me to an oncologist. And the oncologist finally discovered that I had thalassemia, and so I still have the blood tests from 1959 when I graduated from Palmer, when I entered Palmer College. Now, How did I feel at that time? I will tell you that my energy level was reasonably low. I could get by, but my energy level was reasonably low. I fought literally to have jobs every day. I fought literally to go to work every night. When I went to Palmer College, without recognizing it, they forced you, of course, to go into clinic. You were forced to get adjusted. I mean, they didn't understand that there was freedom of choice back then, you understand? And guess what, folks? I started to get adjusted. And I got adjusted on a regular basis. And it was like a rheostat. My energy level increased. My vitality inside my cells changed. I got adjusted every single week and have gotten adjusted every single week since the 60s. And when I don't get adjusted, guess what? I feel it. Now, you could take my blood anytime you want to in those 50 years. Nothing would change. I am, as they say in research, an N of one. Do I go out and say that chiropractic can cure thalassemia? Of course not. But I can tell you that my personal experience with chiropractic and my personal experience with what I've achieved through adjustments on a regular basis, I have a knowing about what it is that that magic of the adjustment does for me. Will it do it for somebody else? I don't know. But I can tell you that I'm an N of one. And so with that knowledge, I can virtually take on anything, and I'll show you what I mean by that in just a minute. And so this Geraldine story is just another one of those. When I opened up in my little community of 5,000 people, I know this is gonna, folks, there was a time when there was no color television. I don't want to disillusion anybody. I want to make anybody fear. When I opened up practice, folks, there was no recording devices. The first Codaphone came out in 1963. So my office had a little apartment that a lady and her two sons, or her son and new daughter, and her husband stayed in. And so one day she sees me on the sidewalk, and she says to me, are you that chiropractor? I said, yes. She says, I live behind you. She says, can you do anything with cerebral palsy? I said to her, I don't know, Mrs. Stubitz, I don't know. I said, but if you want to bring your daughter in, what's the matter? She says, well, she vomits and can hit that wall. Projectile vomiting. What were they doing with the baby? The baby was only a couple months old. They were giving the baby Dilantin. So I said to her, I don't know, Mrs. Stubitz, but I'm certainly willing to try. Baby came in. I adjusted the baby for a few weeks. The projectile vomiting stopped. The pediatrician told Mrs. Stubitz that the baby outgrew it, which is what they always say. Mrs. Stubitz knew better. Now, I don't want to be disparaging to Mrs. Stubitz, but I'm going to tell you something. If she lived down at the end in New Orleans, the mouth of the Mississippi would take on a whole new meaning. This woman would talk to a stone. Well, I'm going to tell you something. She became one of my greatest advocates, and she said to me, you know what? You don't have an answering device. She says, how about putting extension phone in my apartment, and I will happy to answer your phone while you're gone. Anybody'd ever call And Mrs. Stubitz answered the phone, "You don't have a prayer. You're coming into that choir practice whether you want to or not." Did I cure projectile vomiting, folks? I don't think so. I don't know what happened. All I know is there might have been some kind of neurological situation that occurred that when I adjusted that baby, the projectile vomiting stopped. Mrs. Stubitz knew that there was something changed. I knew something changed. I couldn't prove what we did because it's such a bizarre situation. I wouldn't go out and advertise that we cure projectile vomiting. But it happened on N of one. So how do all these affect you? Let me just tell you all. When you get out of here, and I don't care what chiropractic college you graduate from, every student in every chiropractic college in the country, in the world today, will experience a miracle in less than a year out of practice. Now, you can describe that miracle any way you want to. But folks, let me tell you something, as students and as to-be practitioners, if you don't experience a miracle, and incidentally, the miracle doesn't have to be something you see. The miracle has to be what the patient perceives to be your miracle. If you don't get one of those within a year, reassess. What are you doing? Or reassess how you're evaluating your patients, because every one of you will experience a miracle. And when you do, that provides that knowing for when the challenges come, for when the Barretts of the world attack what you do. It's that knowing. It's the actual practice that fortifies our underlying philosophy. Dogmatic reliance is what has gotten us into trouble as a profession, particularly when we overclaim. Be bold in what we hypothesize, be cautious in what we claim. Now, here's where the clinicians and those pointy-headed researchers, who I love kind of dearly, and the educators, they all have a competing battle for which leg of this stool is going to be more prominent. Claim to cure versus a short-term trial. And here's where the problem is. I maintain and I believe our ethics and Hippocratic oath will support that every clinician has not only the right, but the obligation and responsibility to suggest a short-term trial. Now, there is so much more to what we do than our pisiforms. If you just look, off the top of my head, we have lifestyle issues which we have to take into consideration. Genetics, nutrition, education, exercise, sanitation, poverty. Poverty affects the way in which people respond. Spirituality, attitude, environment, culture, trauma, all of those form who we are as practitioners. And frankly, we're probably one of the few professions that actually incorporate most of these into our discussions with our patients. Because unless they change lots of these 1 through 12 things, they're not going to change at all. Their state of health and well-being will not change. So, all of those factors that comprise the patient that sits in front of you, all of which needs awareness, attention, understanding. Now, I like this one, when the hands of the healer meet the needs of the patient, something magic happens. Think about that, folks. There's a, as you know, the old adage, when the student is ready, the teacher will appear. When the teacher is ready, the student will appear. And this has got to be a preparation between you and the patient. It's really not a whole lot different than the parish priest and those who go to church. There's a bond. We call it the doctor-patient relationship. But that transcends a whole lot more than we ever give credit for. You ever notice somebody walked, I'm sure that this didn't ever happen to you, but somebody will walk into a room and you'll feel like all the energy has been sucked out of it, all the oxygen's gone. Ever had that experience? Don't point to who it is. I don't care. And then you have the reverse happen. You have somebody walk into a room and all of a sudden it lights up. There's energy there. Well, what happens? We don't know yet. But I don't know what happens between me and you. I don't know what happens when some human being touches another human being. And folks, you don't only have to touch him with your hands. You touch him with your heart. You touch him with your eyes. You touch him with your mind. You touch him with your compassion. You touch him with your empathy. And every one of you are going to have the experience. And that's the reward, folks. It ain't about money. It ain't about money. It's about something that you can't buy with money. Something that happens magically when a patient comes in and you know that you have them. Something happens. Faith, confidence, trust, belief, all of those seem to pour in. You don't even know what happens. But you can tell that patient almost anything, and they will listen. But you got to build the trust first. Here's the patient needs. The patient needs are complex. I say this, can those needs be met? Well, I want to tell you something, folks. Chiropractic talked about patient-centric before it was a word. That's what we were. That's what the early chiropractors taught. It's about the patient, stupid. Patient-centric. We think it's a new word. Hell, the chiropractor has been patient-centric forever. It's about the patient. The need to be aware of research. Well, there was a time when we sort of scoffed at research, and rightfully so. We didn't have any money to fund it, and nobody was funding it research. Our research was the laboratory of one, and each individual chiropractor had his own laboratory or her own laboratory. You need to be aware of and be a lifelong student because everything changes so rapidly. And isn't it nice to have your weapon armed with the kind of research that I wish I had 35 years ago on that David Susskind show. How I wish I would have been able to pull out a ream of research articles to validate and essentially annihilate Stephen Barrett. The need first to do no harm, that's what we've been talking about. And how do we do harm? I'll tell you how we do harm. We do harm when we exceed what we know is right. When our short-term trial doesn't work, and we're too either ego-driven, economic-driven, or some other divisive way that we don't want to say, I can't help you, Mrs. Jones. You need to be someplace else. Let me help you. Find whoever it is that you need. Short-term trial. First, do no harm, and then think ethics. It's what it's all about, folks. It's all about ethics. And I say this very loudly. Can it be done? Yes. How? Let me put it this way. Words are powerful, absolutely powerful. What we say is critical. Let's be thankful for the researchers who provide us with the evidence to advance our science. We need to pay them the greatest deal of respect and homage. And some of you may wind up being researchers. Let's be thankful for the educators. Some of you may wind up continuing to be educators, good for you, who provide us with the basic underpinnings of our lifetime learning. But, and here's the but, and this is where the divide sometimes comes in. Let's not deny a patient a proper trial of chiropractic care because we can't prove it. And that doesn't mean, however, to sign him up for 6 months or three times a week. That means to provide them with a short-term trial that you're monitoring, assessing the outcomes, and then ethically looking at this enough so to say, it's not working. Let me give you a little secret too, and I don't know where the research comes from. Hopefully the research someday will validate this, but as a 50-year practitioner, let me tell you something. It's across the board. Any of you get into practice and you have a patient come in and in 2 weeks you don't see any change? Your red flags ought to go up and hit the ceiling. Something has to change in those two-week period, in that first two-week period. It doesn't have to be macro, could be micro, but you got to do some assessments to figure it out. And if it's not, have your red flags go up to the ceiling. Something's going on with that patient that's wrong and probably significant, and you don't want to miss it. On the other hand, in our zeal to promote chiropractic in any way that appears to be irresponsible or exploitive, we create the illusion of a well-meaning but uninformed doctor, and not only the individual but the collective profession. It's called cultural authority. You see, in medicine all those years, I never realized it, but if a medical doctor was a scumbag, if he was an unethical practitioner, it was that medical doctor that was bad. But if a chiropractor did the same thing, it wasn't that chiropractor, it was chiropractic. We did not have, folks, the cultural authority to be isolated. We did not have the cultural authority for people to recognize that we have bad apples within our midst as well. So they broad brushed us with all and did it masterfully. Why do you think if we did a word association here today and I mentioned, and you weren't chiropractic students, this was a mixed crowd, and I mentioned the word chiropractic, I'll guarantee you the word quack would come to mind. That's how ingrained this was on an anti-basis. So what we do individually, you have a heavier burden than any other practitioner of any other discipline because you can't afford to do harm to this profession. So let me close with these words. What a joy you have to be a chiropractor. You'll never really work a day in your life. I mean, I hate to say that because that's the way it is. If you do what you love, it's never work. You'll experience a miracle that very few people do. I love the end of a warm hands versus the end of a cold hypodermic any day of the week. Be a lifelong student. Support your profession with time and money. Support your alma mater with time and money. And not only time and money, but your, and I will tell you this from experience, you know, I ran for the House of Representatives and I got lots of money. But you know what else was needed mostly? People to put signs on their lawns. People to knock door to door, people to work at the polls. That's the human labor. That's the human payment. You can give all the money you want, but if you don't give of yourself personally, it's not enough, especially in our profession. We need everybody like that. Support the profession's research efforts. I say that with all of the confidence that I have now left NCMIC and I've taken over our NCMIC foundation. And my goal, folks, is to get that foundation to $25 million so that we have the first organization in chiropractic to be able to spin off $1 million annually from investment income. We've never had a group in chiropractic ever to provide investment income. That's my goal. It's going to be my next challenge. And always be the ethical professional. So enjoy the wonderful profession you have chosen, the myriad of opportunities that await you or pursue. Concepts we only thought about 50 years ago are yours for the taking today. Thank you. I understand. Thank you. Thank you. We have some questions. I understand that there's going to be some questions, and let me give a warning first. Be careful what you ask for, because I do answer them rather candidly.
Yes, I was thinking about that. We do this little questionnaire with all our chiropractic visitors, Dr. Sportelli, and I'm trembling slightly. But here we go. What's your favorite chiropractic word?
Thank you.
Okay, I love it. What's your least favorite chiropractic word?
That's too tough. I don't have a least favorite chiropractic word. I really don't.
Excellent. What is most exciting about being a chiropractor?
Oh, I think I just said it.
Yeah.
It's about that incredible opportunity that you know that you've actually done something and impacted the life of a human being forever. I mean, nothing can replace that feeling, nor can you buy it. It's got to be experiential. And I think that's the greatest thing that you have in chiropractic, what keeps you going every day.
What's least exciting about being a chiropractor?
Well, some of them are horses' asses.
And there it is. What profession other than chiropractic would you like to attempt?
What profession
other than chiropractic would you like to attempt?
Well, I don't know that I'd like to attempt any other profession than chiropractic, but what I have developed a great respect for is law, because law has taken us out of, the legal profession has taken us out of the doldrums relative to the AMA et al. I have been personally involved in marketing, and I think that the marketing profession, if I had to choose something to coexist with my current chiropractic, it would be in marketing and public relations. I think those are two fields that have benefited, that we have benefited from as a chiropractor.
Very good. Is there another profession you would not like to attempt?
I don't think I'd want to be a medic today.
Okay.
I mean, I think at one time it was probably fun to be a medical physician, but I don't think today that it's any fun to be in medicine. And just as a sidebar for you folks, I serve on our board of trustees of our hospital board for the last 26 years. And it's amazing to have watched and witnessed the decline of autonomy in medicine. They're almost all now being employees. They're almost all now wanting to punch in and punch out. And I'm thinking to myself, God, what a strange way to get up in the morning and know you have to punch in, dealing with a profession that deals with sick human beings. The little goal in my office, quite crystal clear, my mission was pretty simple. We started by the clock, we finished by the patient. I don't think there's any ambiguity about that. So that's the kind of the way it works, and that's what made you get up every day. Every day I was the first one at the office, and every day I was the last one to leave joyously. So when you can arrive at that point in time, nothing you do is work.
Very good. Who's your chiropractic hero?
Oh, I think, for me, obviously, I'm a little biased. My chiropractic hero was Dr. Jancy. I had two, actually. Dr. Jancy and Dr. Napolitano, both of whom are gone, but both of whom were giants in polar opposite ends of the chiropractic spectrum, folks. One was National College and the ACA, and Dr. Napolitano was New York College and the ICA. Both of those guys were absolutely wonderful, wonderful human beings, particularly to me. They felt sorry for me, took me under their wing. And I can tell you that I gleaned an awful lot, of not only from history, but I gleaned an awful lot about how to mediate, how to understand that there are differences that are valid, and the valid differences don't necessarily have to be totally resolved. They just have to be understood and heard. I learned that, and that's what those two guys taught me.
Very good. If heaven exists,
pardon?
What would you like to hear God say when you get to the pearly gates?
I need an adjustment.
Okay. Dean Johnson. Dean Johnson is going to read you some questions from our student.
How you doing, sir? These questions are directly from the audience.
I told you about this easy stuff, right?
First question is, what technique do you practice?
Well, I practice them all. And that's a great question. No chiropractor should practice any technique to its exclusivity. What you have, think about this for a minute. You got one technique, if the only tool you have is a hammer, you see every problem as a nail. You've got this whole group. If all of you were going to come into me as patients, you think I could force every one of you into a single technique? So what did I do? I stretched my imagination. I absorbed every technique, not a technique. Incidentally, if you really boil it all down, those techniques were kind of ego-driven anyway. Everybody had to name themselves. Oh, I want to name this guy instead of I want to name this petty. Bull. It's all bull. Do about biomechanics. What's the biomechanic underlying process that enabled that technique to be successful? I learned them all. I learned how to move every bone in this body. And I was actually bragging earlier today. There used to be a chiropractic college in Indiana called Bebout College. Six months. They didn't know much about no Burke learning, but let me tell you something. They knew how to move every bone 16 ways from Sunday. They understood the fundamental biomechanics of moving an osseous structure. So what I did is I learned everything. And every patient that walked into me received an assessment of what they needed, not what I wanted to give them. So I don't have any techniques.
Thank you. How can we as students change the division that exists within the profession today to build a more unified and patient-centered profession in the future?
That's a great question. Whoever asked that question, I compliment you. That's been the same question that's been asked now for about 120 years. I guess the question is, what are we arguing about? I mean, I don't even see. Look, I'm a 52-year-old, 53-year-old practitioner. I've been in practice for 53 years. What the hell are we arguing about? We have a common purpose. We have a common enemy. We have common needs. Do we have differences of opinion? Of course, but we're a family. And in every family, there's dissent. But you sit down at the Thanksgiving table, and you break bread, and you have a great meal. Why are we fighting each other? We're dividing ourselves in more limited and limited fashion. Give me all of us collectively, rather than 71,000 person organizations that can do nothing for anybody, but one 70,000 member organization can do an awful lot. Look, the umbrella is big enough for everybody. So what can you guys do? I'll tell you what you can do as students. You can stop falling into that stupid trap. You can stop listening to people who are divisive. You can start saying, where is my future as the profession? Where's my future? Is my future in divisiveness? Is my future, as Gretzky used to say, I don't skate to where the puck is, I skate to where the puck will be. Where the puck will we be in a couple of years, folks? And you guys have your whole future ahead of us. Think about, where are you going to be in 50 years? Are you going to be here as I am 50 years later, telling you about the joys of a 50-year practice? Or are you going to have no future at all? The puck, folks, is going to be where the, not where we want it to be, but where healthcare and society demands it to be. We don't, you know, the fact of the matter is, I joke about this all the time. There's nobody in the universe here that's going to go to a chiropractor for brain surgery. It just isn't going to happen. Why? Not because we couldn't do a brain surgery if we became brain surgeons, but because we're chiropractors, we don't fit into a brain surgical model. Nobody's going to come to us because they don't believe in the context of what it is. So why are we trying to be something that we're not? We don't demand that. The public will tell us what they want and what they need. And if nobody comes to you, you're going to dry up. The profession would go away if we didn't provide a service that nobody else provided right now, if we didn't do something that was short, that was long on miracles and short on explanations, we wouldn't be here today. I wouldn't be here today telling you about it. So all I can say to you is, God, your students, the hell are you worried about that? Worry about where you're going to be 50 years from now and make sure that you take that course and get there.
Preach. Good stuff. What's the toughest discussion you've had in relationship to chiropractic?
The what, sir?
The toughest discussion you've had in relationship to chiropractic.
The what discussion?
The toughest discussion? The toughest. The hardest.
Oh, the toughest. Okay.
Yeah, hardest. It's hard.
Toughest. Okay.
Most difficult.
Well, you know, the most difficult. Okay.
There you go.
Well, I mean, I will tell you this, I've been indeed fortunate. How many of you have bachelor's degrees here? You know, in case you didn't know it, that really made me feel bad. Let me tell you why. Because when I was about ready to go into chiropractic college, we could go right from high school. And that's exactly what I did. I went right from high school at the Palmer College. Think about that for a moment. You guys have got a degree under your belt before you come here. You've got a rational basis for thinking. I didn't have that thought process, and I was indeed fortunate that my mentors taught me how to think. I have been blessed with mentors all my life, teaching me how to think. And as a result of that, the strategy for where we needed to be as a profession was told to me over and over and over again by people that I trusted and had confidence in. And it was about validating what we said, providing the research to substantiate what we were doing, increase our educational requirements, and making sure the profession was professional. It didn't happen. It didn't happen early back then. We had none of those. And so that's been my whole quest as a result of the most difficult things I've had to encounter, was to look at this profession, and we had none of the ingredients that other professions had to be considered professionals. We had no cultural authority. And so for 50 years, my goal has been to see if we can increase the cultural authority of chiropractic.
Last question, what book would you recommend for growth individually and as a chiropractic? So what book would you recommend for personal growth and professional growth?
Okay, I can't do that. There are no book. How about putting a plural on the end of that? And I just told Dr. McCauley over lunch, in the last 15 years, there have been the most magnificent array of books that have ever in my, I fell in love with books in 1969, thanks to my good friend Charles Tremendous Jones, who incidentally ended his lectures the way I'm going to end mine today, that readers are not always leaders, but leaders are always readers. And his second comment was, you're the same person today you were yesterday, except for two things, the people you meet and the books you read. And I will tell you, folks, books are where it's at. If they had to ask me what my most favorite book is of all times, I will tell you it's Man's Search for Meaning by Viktor Frankl. That's probably has impacted me in my mental thought, because what it in essence says is this: they can strip you of your manuscripts, they can kill your family, they can do everything they want to on the outside. What they can't do is change the way you think about the circumstance. And that's what we need to do in chiropractic. We need to think about where we are today in the circumstance of chiropractic and determine that nothing from the outside is going to make us change once we get on the right path. Folks, I'm going to tell you something. You guys have the greatest opportunity in the world. I know you hear a lot of speakers tell you that. I know it. I lived it for 50-some years. I told Dr. McCauley that there isn't a time in my entire history that I have ever felt as confident about where we are as a profession. What we need to do is bridge the next 3 or 4 years, this gap between fee-for-service and between the way healthcare is moving, if we can bridge this gap, we will emerge that we will need 10 times as many chiropractors as we have in the country today. Thank you all. Appreciate it.